This puzzle was invented by Joel Langer in the 80s, and it's unlike any puzzle I've ever seen before. The challenge is to take this loop of wire out of the bag and then put it back in again. How can this thing be folded back down into a circle that fits inside the bag? It seems impossible, but I know it isn't because I've seen the solved state. It's possible to flatten the puzzle, but it's too big to get back inside the bag. So you try folding it over, but then bits of it pop out, and well, it doesn't look anything like the solved state. I was eventually able to solve this puzzle thanks to Mark Pauly, Mikhail Vidalis and their colleagues. They realised that objects like this are fascinating for all sorts of reasons and they wanted to find out more. And that's really what this video is about, these weird objects. So this is an example of a knot in the mathematical sense. Here's the difference between a regular knot and a mathematical knot. This is a regular knot, but without cutting the rope, I can continuously deform it until the knot disappears. That's because of these loose ends. To create a mathematical knot, you just have to trap the knot by joining the two ends together. In other words, a mathematical knot is a loop of string that can't be untangled. Knot theory is an interesting subject in itself, but this video is about what happens when you create a physical realization of a mathematical knot using elastic material. Here, we're using nitinol wire, and the result is some really weird geometry. So in their paper, Mark and Mikhail went searching for other elastic knots that had interesting properties. Luckily for them, there already exists something akin to the periodic table. But for knots, by the way, there's a really nice theorem about knots that says it doesn't matter how complicated your knot is, it can always be arranged into a braided loop. For example, this knot is equivalent to this braided loop. In other words, it's been proven mathematically that this can be arranged into something like this. Our job is to figure out how. These braided loops aren't stable, by the way, when they're made of nitinol or anything elastic, which is actually really cool because it means they pop up like this. They're springy. Actually, some knots are stable in that braided loop configuration. For example, the trefoil knot is only stable in that configuration when made of an elastic material. But it turns out it's actually quite rare among the periodic table of knots. The simplest knot after the trefoil is called the figure eight knot. And there seems to be three different stable configurations when constructed from nitinol. There's one that's basically flat, that looks like Marvin the Martian. There's this one that looks weirdly asymmetrical. And then there's this arrangement that's actually really nice. I like the fact that it's got the same symmetry as a tetrahedron. Well, not quite as much symmetry as a tetrahedron. So, okay, it has the same symmetry as a tetrahedron where you've colored the edges in a certain way. Anyway, you also get this nice flower arrangement when you look at it straight down. You'll see that a lot with these knots, actually. When I say that a certain knot configuration is stable, I mean that it would be stable even if there weren't any friction. Like, there's a decent amount of friction where the knot is self-touching, but it's still pretty slippery. But Mark and Mikhail were able to show that these three configurations are stable even for a frictionless knot by modeling it in a computer. Interesting quick tangent, it's been proven that all elastic knots are self-touching. In other words, there's no way to make a knot from elastic wire in such a way that no part of the knot touches any other part of the knot. Like, I can force, for example, the trefoil knot into an arrangement that is non-self-touching, but it's not stable, and if I let go, it ends up touching itself again. That might seem completely obvious, but actually it is possible to create a non-self-touching knot with elastic ribbon that has two fixed points. So the case for elastic wire with no fixed points really did need proving. So how did they go about looking for these stable configurations? Well, they would take a knot from the table, like the figure eight knot, for example, and they would draw the knot in 3D simulation software as a bunch of straight lines on a grid, a bit like the Windows Pipe screensaver. The simulation software knows about the elasticity of the wire, so when you hit play on the simulation, it quickly settles down into a stable configuration. A stable configuration is a local energy minima, a bit like rolling a ball down a hill. The ball won't move if it's stationary at a local minimum. But what is this energy that's being minimized in the case of elastic knots? Well, it's the energy that's stored in the bending of the wire. Like, I have to expend energy to bend this wire, and that energy is being stored as elastic potential energy, which can then be released back into kinetic energy, for example. So in this case, low energy means low total curvature. So I know this is stable because any way I try to move it causes the total curvature to increase. It's like trying to push a ball up out of a valley. So that's how you find one stable state, but how do you find all the others? Well, you draw out the knot again in your simulation software, and then you randomly vary the path. Then you press play again, and you see if it relaxes into a new, different stable state that you hadn't seen before. You then repeat that thousands of times and see what you get. So interestingly, this is not an exhaustive approach. We can't be sure that we've found all the stable states. Like if you had three stable states that were really close to each other and you're randomly picking a starting point in that energy landscape, you may never pick the starting point that's gonna get you to that middle stable configuration. I'm showing a 1D energy landscape here, but it would actually have many dimensions. What's really cool is that Mark and Mikhail were able to find three stable states of the figure eight knot that no one had ever seen before. And for the more complicated knots, they discovered loads of new ones. The next simplest 3D knot after the figure eight is this one. It doesn't have a name, I don't think, but its designation is 940 because it's arbitrarily the 40th knot with nine crossings. This one also comes in Butterfly and Marvin the Martian, but with 3 feet. This knot is more complicated, and as a result, it's more springy. That's quite a jump, isn't it? This is a simpler one that creates a sort of bow tie. If I try to pull this into a 3D shape in the same way that I would with the others by pulling these lobes in, you can see why the arrangement isn't stable. You see, because this isn't locked in position. This knot simply doesn't have the right arrangement of overs and unders to keep that in place. This one is a really good puzzle knot because it's also got a stable configuration that looks like this, and getting from that back to the bow tie is really hard. So this one is a flat knot and always will be. It does still have a Marvin though. Let's go back to the original puzzle knot from Langer then, because I think I have what I need now to solve the puzzle. For a while, I didn't think it even had a stable flat configuration because like if I put it into the butterfly shape, this part of the rod here isn't locked in place. So when I let go, it switches back to the three-sided container thingy. But actually, if I go back to the forced butterfly and do my usual trick to turn it into Marvin, actually, there you go. There is a stable flat configuration. So what is the trick to get it back in the bag? Well, I noticed with this knot, the way you do it is to look end on and squish it like that. And it kind of flips into that arrangement. In other words, I need to line up these two little triangles and squish them together. The puzzle knot doesn't have little triangles, it has big triangles, and that's the problem. But look, if I squeeze it to make little triangles and then push those little triangles together, that solves the puzzle and I can get it back in the bag without letting go, otherwise it'll pop up again. If you look at their paper, they've got this brilliant image on the front and I really wanted to recreate that, a person-sized elastic knot. So I bought 20 meters of camping tent poles. You know how putting up a tent can be quite challenging? Well, this was like an order of magnitude harder. If all this is making you think about those tents that put themselves up, well, me too. And in fact, it's such an interesting topic that I made a whole video about it. Link to that in the card and the description. But look, I did get it done in the end. Surprisingly, at this scale, the weight of the rods is enough to keep it in that unstable configuration of a braided loop. But if I begin to lift some of the bars up just a little bit, it pops out quite quickly. But if I give it a little guidance on the way up, I can form that brilliant three-dimensional knot. These tent poles definitely deformed plastically a little bit during the construction, unlike the nitinol, which just has incredible elastic properties. I wanted to see if I could get it to pop up on its own, so I made the whole thing much tighter by removing a few of the rods. In the end, it was still held down by its own weight, but it didn't have to be lifted up as much before it took off, and when it did, it was more violent. So William Thomson hypothesized that atoms were knotted vortices in the ether, and he tried to create an actual periodic table of elements by creating a table of all possible knots, like hydrogen is the figure eight knot, helium is the sinkerfall knot, and so on. It's such a beautiful idea, part of me wishes it was true, but it's not. And the truth is important. Like in science, we have a pretty robust system for getting at the truth, but the scientific method isn't how most people learn new science. Most people get their science news from, well, the news. Even if the facts are accurate, you have to worry about like How is the story being spun and what's being left out? That's not just true for science, it's true for politics, economics, culture, everything. How do you know if your news source is politically biased, if their reporting is serving an agenda? One solution is the sponsor of this video, Ground News. Ground News was created by a former NASA engineer to empower readers to navigate the complex media landscape. They process about 60,000 articles a day from news sources around the world and group related stories together so that readers can compare news coverage in real time. And you get all this extra information about sources, like do they have a political bias? How reliable is their reporting practices? Who owns them? For example, this science story about climate change, you can see a summary of how a news story is being reported differently across the political spectrum, or you can click in and read for yourself. As someone who reads a lot of science news, it's been eye-opening to see how a news story that really should be neutral is being reported differently on either side of the political spectrum. Seeing science news and all news contextualized in this way, I think is really important. And wherever you sit on the political spectrum, perhaps you'll agree with me that polarization is bad. And maybe a bit of understanding and empathy for the other side could really help. If you're interested, the offer on this one is really good. If you go to ground.news/Steve Mould, you'll get 40% off the Vantage plan, which gives you unlimited access to every single Ground News feature. The link is also in the description, so check out Ground News today. I hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, don't forget to hit subscribe, and the algorithm thinks you'll enjoy this video next.